Matthew Lesko, and stay tuned for Top of the Morning Baltimore.
We got up before dawn just to bring you
Top of the Morning from beautiful downtown Boston.
Top of the Morning, Baltimore.
The top of the morning to all of you.
Top of the morning.
Top of the morning.
Kumar.
And today we have an exciting show for you. We have Matthew and his wife Wendy Lesko, and Matthew's the question mark guy you haven't seen around town. Should be a great show.
This is going to be an interesting show. He's going to talk about money and grants and how we get grants from the government. So.
That's right, and just for it's for everybody, not just for like low income or anybody. It's like all kinds of people.
It's going to be interesting.
So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Matthew Lesko, and stay tuned for Top of the Morning Baltimore.
Welcome back. With us, we have a special guest, Matthew Lesko, and his wife, Wendy. And if you're not familiar with him, if you haven't seen him riding his scooter around Rockville, he's the question mark guy.
So she welcome. Calls me something else.
Yeah, but this is a family show, so we can't say it on.
That's not true.
That's right. So, Matthew, I'm sure you get this a million times, but why the question mark, too?
Why not? Actually, it's pretty philosophical to me. I mean, it's something I always wanted to do my whole life. I mean, as a kid or whatever, I didn't have the courage to do it till my 50s. Yeah. But, and I don't know, I wanted some kind of outfit or something, but I've always been in information. So, I mean, I've had, you know, I have an MBA in computers from the 70s and things like that. But questions, and I see in our mind, in our life now, we have, you know, how many stations now? You know, we got 200 stations or 400 or whatever the heck it is. You know, how many magazines and websites? So we have more information now than we ever had in the history of mankind. Actually, if you go up and read the research, like in the last 50 years, we've created more information in our society, and this is all over the world, than we have in the previous, like, 2000. So we're generating out information. So to me, the information is easy. It's out there. There's information on it. You can Google any word and get a million websites. But it's asking the right questions. See, that's what life is about now. It's not getting the answers. They're easy. Ask the right questions. What was the question again?
What do you mean? Well, I mean, all you have to do is just, you know, go into Google or ask.com and just type in your question.
Yeah, but see, that's the problem. See, I mean, the computer handles volume, you know, and quantity, you know, but not quality. Like in my work, you know, what I do is try to show people how to get take advantage of government programs and things like that. So people think government and government money, they think, oh, I want a grant, you know. So they'll put in grant in Google. Well, if you do that, you're going to get like 54 million websites.
You're going to get a huge grant.
Right. But what are you going to do with 54 million websites? You know? See, the problem is, too, is that that's not even the right question to ask about money from the government. Because 80% of the free money that the government gives out is not even called grants. So if you're putting in grants in Google, you know, you're missing out 80% of the free money. You're also getting huge grant, too, but besides that. See, so that's why knowing something well enough to ask the right question, that's what I think is important in our information society, and we have to spend more time formulating the right question to ask.
So what other kinds of programs do you do around town and things like that?
Well, my whole life is really built around educating, you know, people in America about what their government has to offer.
Yeah,
well,
Matthew, honestly, I mean, do most average Americans qualify? I mean, there must be, like, income limitations or, you know what I mean?
Yes, and that's true. You may qualify, you may not, you know, but no matter what income level you are, you're qualified for something. and that's it. Like, now I was talking to a woman Actually, here right in Baltimore, it came up. We were at a coffee shop interviewing, and she works for an office in town here where if you lose your job, you go to our office and get like up to $8,000 to train for a new job. And I said, what's the income requirement? Could you be a millionaire? Yes. You could be a millionaire and go into this office and get $8,000 to train for a new job. They'll also help you fill out a resume. They'll help you, you could use their Xerox machine for free. You could use their computers for free and everything to look for a job. They'll help you write your resume and everything, all for free, and you could be a millionaire and do this, and plus get the money, But nobody knows, and that's the key to this.
That's interesting. I didn't even know
that. You're looking for work.
What are some of the most common and readily available grants and money that's out there that the government has?
Well, that one, to me, it's information even is more powerful in our society, than money. I mean, you get $100,000 to start a business or something, but boy, if you don't know where to put that business, you don't know how to do a business plan, you don't know how to do accounting, and that's for free too. Even free legal help, and things like that. And my wife, in her work, she uses government a lot too, that people just don't know about.
We've heard enough from you, Matthew. Let's hear what your wife has to say about you. Get the real scoop.
Well, you were asking about using Google,
right.
Put in a question. And it's very interesting. If you do that most of the time, you never get a GOV, a gov site. So that's one of the reasons this guy exists and is so needed, because the government's not able to advertise. And people have such a negative attitude about, government's the problem, not the solution. And we think it is the solution. It's part of the solution.
I mean, it seems like if it's not available to most Americans, that they would go to the other sites, like the commercial sites, other than the government.
And that's true. Commerce. The web is now commerce. So for you to be on the first page, of a thing, you have to pay to be there. Right?
Yeah.
So the government's giving away for free. So they can't afford to pay to be there. People are selling you something. Pay to be there, so that's what you find out about. You don't find out about the good stuff.
So, give us an example. What's like a crazy story?
How I found my pink shoes.
Government auctions.
Yeah.
But you can't.
Like one of the government programs you uncovered, and maybe one of the people that you've helped.
Well,
what about the
story?
Maryland Health Service program you just discovered?
Oh, I mean, now. I mean, there's, I was helping a young woman, a single mom, working full-time and everything, and then trying to get health coverage or whatever. And there's a very popular program in the state, most states, for children's health care and get covered. So your kids, if you make a certain income, and it'll go up to like $40,000, $50,000 a year.
Like women, infants, and children?
Well, it's part of the WIC, women, infants, and children, but it's really the health, what they're talking about, what Bush didn't reauthorize a couple months ago. and it's really health care for kids who can't afford it, and it's for middle income, and that's the issue. But now, I went around and talked to four different agencies to see if this woman was qualified, and I got a different answer every person I talked to. See, so,
really?
I mean, yes, and it's so amazing. I mean, this is a very popular program. It's not some little out-of-the-way thing people don't know about. I mean, this is a major program. And that astounded me. I mean, I know this stuff. People didn't know this stuff.
And he knows how to ask questions.
Right,
so let's remember that part.
Or there was another program I never heard about. Like here in Maryland, I mean, there's a program for free that you get health care. And it's like,
but it's...
Pardon me?
Alphabet soup.
Right, exactly. And it's not for hospitalization, but for visits and prescription drugs. So it's all these other things, to care for daily expenses, which has a very high income. See, nowadays, $40,000 or $50,000 is almost like, what's called low income now. So people walking around, I don't know about you, but that's pretty big money for a lot of people. So they don't even know they're eligible for it. I would think. That's the other problem. People don't realize they're eligible even for these low income programs. Then we have programs for millionaires. A millionaire will find out about them. They'll hire somebody or whatever to find out about this stuff and take advantage of it. And that's why, to me, God, we need someplace, where the average person, could understand more to take advantage of it.
So, Jeff, I know you're really curious about.
Where did this whole thing come from? I mean, did you also one day say, "Hey, I'm going to be the expert on grants"?
Ride my scooter around Rockville.
People think that I have some big master plan. It's all by accident, and it's trying to have fun, tell you the truth. I mean, I have an MBA in computers, and I had two businesses that failed before I got into this. And, it was wonderful. Failing is I think, the best thing that happens to any of us. Then I started a business down in town with my MBA, helping Fortune 500 companies in mergers and acquisitions.
Downtown of
Washington, D.C. Sorry. And these Fortune 500 companies would come to me, and they'd want to start like a chain of pasta stores, you know. And I was just a huckster selling my time, you know, for as much as I could get. I didn't know anything about pasta stores. So I run around Washington to try to find out information about pasta. I said, the government has an expert, the Department of Commerce, getting paid like 80, 90, 100 grand a year studying pasta stores. So I'd find this guy, and he'd give me free market studies on pasta. What's hot, what's not? He'd show me what money programs are available to start pasta stores. And I'd take all this stuff and take his name off, put my name on, nothing the government is copyrighted. And I'd sell it to these Fortune 500 companies for tens of thousands of dollars. Yeah? And I didn't know anything about this stuff, yeah? And that's how it started. If you have back pain, how do you know you get a free report at NIH? They'll show you, like, 50% of back pain operations are not worthwhile, you know? And if you bring that to your doctor, man, you got something to talk about, yeah?
Right. Wow, so how long have you been doing this?
20, 30 years or something like that. I started when I was about six and a half. No, I
But the suit sort of evolved out of this existential proposition,
yeah.
And he really wanted the bigger closet.
Where can
yes,
I get one?
Yes, yes.
I want one in
actually,
every color.
Actually, there's a woman, Ava. Ava is my seamstress lady. She's terrific in Baltimore.
Ava Baby.
Go to AvaBaby.com.
And the other thing is, he does get requests from all over the country on Halloween to send his suits out for costumes. So he hasn't gotten into the costume rental business yet, but it's possible.
But it's fun. I mean, people don't know me. And, you know, now I feel it's almost an obligation. Love wearing them. I go anywhere, people smile at me. I have the courage. I don't have all this testosterone as a 30-year-old. You know, they have to worry about, you know, defending my honor.
Wendy, what did you think when he started wearing these suits?
Well, it started because our two sons started painting our cars. We had a boring gray Corsica car, and we could never find it in the airport. So they started decorating cars, and we went to various versions. And then I really do think it sort of morphed from a car that is very recognizable in town to really being recognizable everywhere you go. And that's what's, and it is great. And people who aren't curious, you really have to worry about. That's a clue. If people don't react to this, what is wrong with you? You know,
right.
So.
It is, depending on the zip code, you know, what people how people react, you know, the snobbier zip codes. They try to pretend they don't even see me.
It's
you know?
True.
And no, it's absolutely true. And the kids will be walking down. They'll be walking down with their kid. You know, and the kid, "Mommy, mommy, look at that guy! Look at you know." They're crying. Oh no, don't pay that. And it's just amazing what some people.
So, how many suits do you own, actually?
She told you know how the master bedroom has the big closet for the woman.
Yeah. Right.
I got that one. I got about 17 of these now. It's terrible.
My God. What do your kids think? What do they think of Dad wearing this contraption out in public?
I think they're okay with this. You know, they have different reactions, but basically, I think what they've really taken from Matthew is a sense of general individual empowerment, and that it's so important to find something that you care about and do, and not just for the sake of making money, but what is it that you can do to contribute to this world? And actually, that's why we really wake up in the morning for the same reasons, because while he's saying, you know, if you want to start a business, if you want to go back to school, if you want to move into another career, you know, don't overlook this incredible resource that your tax dollars pay for. And I work in a rather different area, but in some ways it's all connected, and that is, I work with young people, and in fact here in East Baltimore, a project with Maryland Legal Aid, which is to engage young people to look at problems regarding suspension, expulsion, street lights being out, relations with police, all of that. And from a youth perspective, what is working, what isn't, what are their own ideas of how to change things? And to really engage them, because so often, again, it comes back to don't mess with politicians, don't mess with government, they're corrupt. You know, you don't want to deal with them. And in fact, no, these are the very people who solve problems and don't ever hear from ordinary folks. They hear from the hired guns. And so it's to really try to persuade young people that, first of all, their ideas about what's wrong or their ideas for change are worthy and how they can be taken seriously, but then how to connect them, again, with the government policymakers whom we elect.
Wow, so you're really involved in Baltimore.
With this particular project, it's terrific. And the young people, of course, defy all the negative stereotypes. And if you just give them a chance and give them an opportunity, they can really move forward. So it's a very new program.
Right. Now, has this group of young people, have they met your husband?
They love it when I drive the question marks car to the community center. And quite frankly, you hit on a really good point because, you know, I'm too old for, you know, I'm in my mid-50s, you know, and she's
what?
An old lady. And, you know, she's an old lady and, oh, you know, what are these young people going to? But it's because I drive this question mark car, I have an entree.
So,
you're
cool,
right.
Right.
You're right.
I think you're
I
cool.
get a lot. It's right. I haven't. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's true.
Oh, that's funny. Now, Matthew, what other programs are you doing around town? Like, where can we see you wearing this question mark?
Come on over. Tomorrow morning, I'll have another one. I wear them every day, every day. Weekends, not as much, but now they're sneaking in. I have, like, jeans with just one question mark off my butt, you know, or something. Or a sport jacket with just one big question mark. So they're sneaking into my casual wear.
An excuse to buy more
exactly,
clothes.
Exactly. It's terrible. I mean,
do you do public speaking?
Yeah, I mean, anywhere, you know, you get two people in a corner, and I'll give you 20 minutes. I got a high school going on Friday. What was that? Yeah. Kennedy High School.
Kennedy High School in Silver Spring, Maryland.
What are you going to talk to these high school students?
I'm not really sure. I mean, I don't know if they're at the stage. I mean, what I like talking, particularly young people. Young people watch a lot of TV, so they know me, you know. And it's really failure, probably, I'll talk about. And how to find your, because young people, even old people, we don't get encouragement to fail. Finding what's weird about you. I mean, I feel like, you know, see, this was inside me my whole life, and just it didn't come out to my 50s, you know. And if I found that earlier, you know, and I think that's what we have to find. And I think what's weird about any of us is our best part. Because no one else could do that as well as you can.
That's right, so find your inner weirdness.
Exactly.
Ah, that's a good book title.
Right, exactly. Because that's what's really your biggest asset, and most of society will try to beat it out of you, be like something mm-hmm. else, when in mm-hmm. fact, we don't need something else. We need different, you know, and so it's hard to find what's different about you. So, I mean, to me, the clue is, hey, what's weird about you? What do people think is weird about you? That's probably close to what's different about you, which you should grow. You know, you don't hide it, you grow it. Take anything that's weird about you and grow that sucker big as possible. Because that's your best asset you have to share with the rest of us, yeah.
Well, you can team up with Oprah.
Yeah,
right?
It's a major stage.
Yeah, right. I've been on Oprah a few times. And actually, I remember it was before I wore question mark suits the last time I was on. She was here in Baltimore.
Yeah,
she
we wrote a book together. Called The Maternity Sourcebook.
We worked with Oprah here when she was still
That's
here.
Right.
We wrote a maternity
great.
Book right here in Baltimore. Be sure we're not there. And then she brought me out a couple of times in the beginning. And the last time, a couple of years ago, I worked. And I remember walking out, and before question mark suit, I still wear lots of loud clothes. I remember walking out, and she introduced me. She looked at my clothes, and she said, "You must have to be real secure to dress like
that." That's great.
And which
That's
was a nice,
nice
compliment.
Yeah,
I remember
it is.
Yeah. And the one thing I remember about her, every time I worked with her, she had this remarkable, she has a remarkable ability, I'm sure she still does, and this is what her success is. What's her weirdness is that mm-hmm. when you're in her presence, she could make you feel like you're the only person in the world.
Yeah. Right, makes you feel special.
And just make you feel like there's no other person in the world. We all crave that in one way or another.
Yeah.
Well, some of us are a little more egotistical
than
the others.
Right.
Yeah, to crave that. But yeah, I mean, that's her special thing. But no, we're going up and knock on doors for a week or two. For the primary.
Are you really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
It should be fantastic. You know, in D.C., no voting rights, so
right.
it's sort of a bore there.
Right.
So, and Maryland's sort of boring, too, politically. You know, it's so So yeah, no, it's going
to
be.
But now our other son is he went to the University of Maryland and has got government money too, a great state program for high tech people that he got, and that's right. Wasn't income determined. I make more money than I ever thought I'd make.
But you helped him find the money,
absolutely,
right?
and teach both of those that we want to do something. You know, it takes effort. The other boy found a local scholarship program. Mm-hmm. You know, I never even knew about. He found it himself. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean it just takes effort. I mean, that's the key. I make it sound easy or whatever, but everything in life. That's why I think if you find your weirdness or whatever, you put in that effort more because you want to do that.
You know what? I remember the story you mentioned about like your two sons and the cigarette machine.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, why don't you share that with everybody? I think that's a great
Wendy's
story.
They
got very involved with tobacco use, particularly among children and teens. But they were involved from the time they were 6 and 9 and went to our county council in Montgomery County with evidence that they were able to buy packs of Marlboro from cigarette vending machines with no one interfering.
Right, with the camera, right?
With actually old pre-digital Polaroid camera, you know, on their scrawny little poster, and they just slam dunked the tobacco lobbyists and basically came to Annapolis several times, and I had a very different experience there. But basically, they throughout high school they remained involved and got a government grant, which was a carbon monoxide machine, so one could test their lung capacity. I can't remember right now, but basically they got a $10,000 grant to buy these machines and to use them in high schools all over Montgomery County as a way for young people to really understand if their lung capacity was compromised because of tobacco. But and now it's natural for them. If they think something's wrong or there's a good idea, they say, well, maybe is this something we should go to Tom Perez at the Department of Labor or Governor O'Malley or U.S. Representative Chris Van Hollen? It's a part of growing up.
I mean, she taught me that, and watching the boys, because I mean, I grew up in a little town called Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Thing, anybody who did anything, you know, with a law person, you had to go to Harvard or something to do all that kind of stuff. And I saw my 6-year-old kid go over there and get a law changed. You know, 6 years old. God.
But it's similar, again, to Matthew's stuff, which is people think it's only the Lockheed Martins that basically can get these, you know, can get government procurement and all that. His sister has a great art business, framing and putting up pictures and IRS and the Postal Service. And, you know, this is this is just an ordinary person who was willing to take the chance and possibly fail.
Wow. So do you think, I mean, your two sons, when they were 6 and 9, that experience changed them?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, I mean, because of that, I mean, they were in the White House like 3 times or something.
Wow.
They wouldn't let me in the gate.
He's a threat. Yeah. Believe me.
You know, it's amazing. And they've been, resumes.
It helps getting scholarships and all that.
Yeah.
That's not the reason for young people to be activists.
But, I mean, I learned watching them that how, because I never knew that side changing policy. I just said, I want to use this sucker, I want to change it. You know, and show people how to use it. But how almost the same skills can be used to change it. You don't like your life, you could change it.
That's
you know, it takes some organizing, it takes some effort and everything, but if you hate your job, you could change it. You're willing to put in the work. You hate society, you could change it, willing to put in the work. And that's what this democracy is. It's hard, but boy, if you can't do that in many other countries.
Now, what happened to you between like 40 and 50 where you decided to just like blossom, if you were a late bloomer,
I don't know. I always wanted a business. I didn't care. I was starting businesses. I got an MBA in computers back in the 70s. I had a software company that failed, and another company that failed. So after 2 failures, then the business helping Fortune 500 people do this was successful. And that grew to about 30, 40 people down on K Street. So I was like one of those Washington lobbyists, on K Street helping rich people get things from the government. But I got bored after doing that. That's where we met. She was working for another bunch of rich people getting Washington.
Right?
And
only people who could afford our products.
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
That's the problem.
And I said, how do we get how do I get the average person? I got a book deal with someone in New York, you know, an agent saw me and became a New York Times bestseller. Wow! I flunked English in college. Yeah. And I called up my English teacher and told her I got a New York Times bestseller. And that was just more fun. You know, I could act crazy.
When was that?
Oh, back in the early 80s, you know. When I would go and try to educate people in business, like give seminars at Procter & Gamble or Citicorp Bank, and all, nobody would have fun. They would not have fun. You know, they're afraid to show their emotions and with their peers.
Might be a little robot.
Exactly. And you know, I wouldn't know till 5 months later that I did a good job because, you know, I'm out there working my heart out, man. I want applause now. And now that's why I'd rather give a speech at the library up here. I can pick my nose, do anything. You know, we all have fun, and I know right away whether they like it or not. You know.
And young people.
Yeah, and it just wasn't satisfying. And recently, I went up to give a speech at Harvard Business School. They wanted to know about branding because they think I was this branding guru.
Right.
Yeah, and it was so funny. Because the essence of my speech was, it was an accident, you know.
Not a $5,000 consultant.
Exactly, right. It's an accident.
More like $5 million.
But more important, there were those kids that were there, young people. I felt the same way when I was giving the speeches 20, 30 years ago at Procter & Gamble, the same. And it hurt my heart to feel their pain. I felt their pain. I just felt how uncomfortable they were. They weren't themselves. They were all trying to be something. I have no idea.
Must conform.
Yeah, it makes me tear up. You know, even, I mean, they enjoyed it. It wasn't too much of it. But, that's right about being your weirdness. I mean, I think we're here for so short a time, and if we don't express ourselves the way we need to, that we're not only missing it, but the world is missing it for not having that from you.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah. Now, Matthew, I just have one last question for you. Where can I get a suit like that?
I'll give you mine.
Thank you. I'll just take it in good. A little bit.
You know, it's a whole other look.
Exactly.
All right.
Actually, it's really good with your hair.
Yeah,
it does. I think it's a good color.
Good coloring.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Gotta get your shoes.
Yeah. I'll get my shoes. Wow. I got a jacket out of this.
That's good.
Now, how can people contact you? How can they get in touch with you?
Well, for Smiley, that's what I call her, Smiley.
Okay, it's the youthactivismproject.org or 1-800-KID-POWER.
And for me, it's governmentmoneyclub.com.
Government Money Club.
Right, so you show you the money.
Yeah, actually, you gave me a membership.
Oh, yes, yeah. Yes. I hope you got the video, too. I want to make sure that you got that. Yeah. But somebody wrote me they did, so maybe I failed. I screwed up a lot.
All right, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.